Good morning, good afternoon. I would like to thank the organizing committee of this great symposium for the opportunity to present to you my thoughts on the power of real-world observation. I'm Anna Battistatou, I'm professor of pathology and head of Faculty of Medicine in University of Ioannina, Greece. I'm a pathologist, and as you know, the medical specialties where diagnosis heavily relies on images are pathology, radiology, and dermatology. However, in all medical specialties, in order to acquire medical expertise, accurate observation is very important. This skill is inherited, but also it can be cultivated. And in recent years, it has been included in medical curricula via introduction of medical humanities. Attention to details is very important in order to get to the correct diagnosis, no matter what your specialty is. Before that, though, all students need to exercise in appreciation of size, shape, and color. There are well-known visual traps that have been published as a part of research in psychology, in the medical field, in physics, in mathematics, and these include illusion of size, perception of brightness, colors and hues, lateral inhibition, inattentional blindness, and more. This would be the subject of another talk. In this presentation, I'm going to show you images, and I hope that I will convince you that it is very didactic to engage medical students and young residents in the art of observation by using real-world nature images. These are images they can easily relate to. Natural scenes can be used for stressing the importance of observation and draw attention to potential pitfalls. Today, in the COVID era, it is very important that we increase the connection with the real world. In these days, we are living in an increasingly virtual world, and there is a danger of losing our real world connection. The danger is even greater for our young students and residents. We have all the time lately COVID-induced distance learning, and there is the danger that this will increase the tendency the young students already have to distance themselves from real-world reality in favor of the virtual one. In this distance learning, we might empower the out-of-the-world, secluded worlds they already live in, and they have the tendency to engage in this world, in the virtual world, in the machine-based world. It is our duty, then, to make an effort to bring real-world images and paradigms in an effort to maintain a real-world connection in a world that is increasingly virtual. In the next few slides, I have grouped natural images I use for my students into 9 paradigms where examples and paradigms of key features are grouped. Paradigm 1, the key feature, the important clue to diagnosis, may be partly hidden or may be difficult to discriminate from the environment. Let's see some natural images that support this. This is fairly easy. This is the first image I'm showing you. We have a cat. You saw it already. It is partly hidden between trees. It is fairly easy to see. This one is a little bit more difficult. We have a peacock that is hiding, half hiding behind trees. Here, even more difficult, we have a lizard. This lizard is on plain sight, on the top of the rock under the sun. However, it is quite difficult to see it, although it's in front of your eyes. Here, a grasshopper is partly hidden in a basil plant. And here, we have a caterpillar on a plant branch. You can see it now. This is a fairly difficult one. You can look at it very carefully. You can see a yellow butterfly on a red geranium. Here it is. And here, if you are very careful, you can see another butterfly on a bush. This is an easier one. You can see, if you are careful, a starfish on the Ionian seabed. Or again, in the sea, you may see a medusa that is swimming in the Pagasetti Gulf in the city of Greece. This is the more difficult one. Even if I tell you what it is a crab in the Preveza harbor. I'm sure that you have difficulty, most of you even now, recognizing it. That's what my students said. They said this was the most difficult image to realize. There is the crab in the harbor. So this concludes our paradigm one set of images. In paradigm two, I want to tell you and show you that the key feature may be visible. It is always visible. But maybe you need higher magnification in order to look to see it. Here, higher magnification is not necessary. You can see a bee on a flower. It is easily discernible due to its size and the adequate magnification. Yes, but how about here? What do you see here? We have a marble exterior in Ioannina. On the marble, there are three bugs. In the low magnification, they are almost undetectable. Here they are now. However, on higher magnification, I don't even need to highlight you the red bug that you can see on the right on the marble exterior. In the lower magnification, it was difficult to see them. Even if you did, you wouldn't realize what they are. In paradigm three, I want to show you that maybe sometimes the important clue to diagnosis is the feature that is dissimilar to anything else. I have two paradigms in this one. You can see the blue pansy that is among the white ones. This should be abnormal. It is something different between everything that is the same. As well as the purple bougainvillea flowers among the white ones. When you see that in a microscopic image, two or three cells that are different from the others, you have to look very carefully. Here they are. And this concludes our third paradigm. For paradigm four, brightness, particularly the object edges, can interfere with perception. I have here a set of three images to prove you that. Here what you can see. You can see a brown butterfly on a leaf. That is the leaf on the left image. In the middle, you can see nothing. You can just see a leaf and the bright sun shone light on the leaf. In the middle image, when the light changes a little bit, you start seeing something, you're not sure what it is. On the right image, though, you can easily see a brown butterfly. You see how important magnification and also change of life, light and perspective are in order to appreciate the real information that the image wants to show you. We're going to paradigm five. The perception of size, which is very important in many diagnoses, varies. It varies according to the surrounding objects. Let's see this image. What you can see? You can see a very big sea urchin, and maybe this one is the one that draws your attention. However, the important part in this image is this very little plant that was able to grow on the rocks. And you can even see the plant because it has a small shadow, as you can see that. Sometimes from the shadow, you can see that something else is there. For paradigm six, careful observation of the environment provides clues on the nature and origin of objects. Let's see some examples of this. What do you see here? What do you see here is a blue pillow. The blue pillow has a printed yellow leaves, so maybe you won't notice that not all yellow leaves are the printed ones on the pillow. There is one yellow leaf and it is on the upper corner of the circle that I'm showing you there that is not printed on the pillow. It is a real yellow leaf that has fallen from the tree above. If you look on the right image, you can see that there are plenty of fallen yellow leaves from the tree, and this one was another one of these. It just happened to be on top of the pillow. So you have to see the surrounding to realize where it came from, as well as this image. There is a eucalyptus branch on the seabed. What is it doing there? Of course, we know that eucalyptus does not grow in the sea. However, eucalyptus grows very well by the sea. So if you look up and you see the sky, you will notice that there is a whole eucalyptus tree just nearby the sea where the branch came from. So now we know where the branch came from. Here I have a more difficult one. There is a snail on the pavement. This one I'm showing you now is a snail. If you go closer, maybe you will recognize it. But it is easier to recognize it, even if you don't go closer, if you look on the right side of the image, where you can see the trail of the snail. So by seeing the trail of the snail, you can realize that the one you are seeing in the middle is actually a snail, even if the magnification is lower. So always pay attention to the surrounding environment. That will give you many clues for the correct diagnosis. What do we have here? Here we have a flying object. A flying object on the left might be a bird. Actually, it's not a bird. Actually, it's a kite. And you can see it's a kite because if you are very careful and you look around in the sky, you can see many more kites flying on the sky. So this one must be a kite as well. For paradigm 7, detailed scanning of the image is necessary, particularly when the finding is unexpected, and as such, it might be overlooked. Let's see this beautiful image. This is a seashore, it is very nice. You can see the beach, you can see a small boat, you can see the mountains, you can see the sky, and maybe after all this, you disregard, you do not see the watermelon peel. This is the unexpected finding. It's in the middle of the image, but I'm sure that you didn't notice it at the beginning when you were seeing very nicely the beautiful scene. The same here. We have a beautiful scene from the sea. And here we have also an unexpected finding. We have a yellow pencil that is situated within a seaside rock. This is an unexpected finding, easily overlooked if you just adore the scene that you are looking at. Here again, not so unexpected, but again, a finding. We have a bird nest on a tree. Maybe by looking at all this information here, you lose this big bird nest. You immediately recognize it when somebody points it to you. Here again, we have a beautiful seashore. There is a cliff. And maybe you look at the sea, you look at the mountain, and you didn't recognize to have several wild goats on the cliff. Here again, an unexpected finding. There is a stork in its nest just by the road. Paradigm 8. Imagination and intuition are important, particularly when interpreting images without immediately apparent meaning. Let's see some examples from from nature. Here we see two images. I'm sure you cannot understand what they are. I have to explain them to you, and then they will make sense. We have a dim light in the dark. Then we have two yellow lights, small yellow lights in the dark. These proved to be fireflies that were caught in a spider web at the stairs leading to a basement in a house. When the light was turned on, you couldn't see the small yellow lights from the fireflies, but you can see the fireflies caught in the net of the spider. Walking by the side of the road, you may see this white material. No, it is not snow. When you look up, you can see that there are poplars. So this is the fluff of the poplars glowing in the area. Then again, a nice image again that can draw your attention. There is a cut tree, and this draws a lot your attention. So you may fail to observe that there are numerous ants on the trunk, the cut tree trunk. You are very much absorbed by this nice painting on the tree, and you don't see the numerous, many, many, many ants that are on the tree trunk. And last, two more images of one paradigm, paradigm 9. Occasionally, they must make sense, since it is related to previous memorized similar images. However, the interpretation is impossible. I'm sure you're going to enjoy these two images. So what is it? Is it a horse on the pavement? And here? Is there a person within the trunk of the tree in the middle? Is it curved in the tree trunk? No, it's an incidental finding on the tree trunk. So I hope in these few minutes that I had, I persuaded you that real world can teach us the art of observation to be applied in real world diagnostics. These are the references. I'm sure you're going to find them very helpful. I thank you very much for your attention. Enjoy the meeting.